I'd like to say it's not true for this area. You know, Selbyville, the surrounding area is a pretty rural area, and you'd think that in a rural farming area, that the reliance on God would be really strong, because how are you going to have crops without God? I mean, he's the one that gives the increase, and we all sort of know that on the inside, but the census that was done, the American census done in 2010, actually says this part of Sussex County is below the national average when it comes to people being affiliated with any type of religious organization, whether it be Protestant, Catholic, Buddhist, whatever. That only about 30% of the citizens of Sussex County claim to have any religious affiliation at all. That's a pretty, sort of bothers me, to be truthful with you. Less than 20% of the people who live in Selbyville claim to be regular church attenders. And the ones who do, that say they're regular church attenders, attend church 1.7 times a month, or an average of 20 times a year. That's what is now considered to be a regular church attender. Mm-hmm. At one point in time, it was 3 times a week, 150 times a year, and now we're down to about 20 times a year for people who claim to be regular church attenders. And we all know the statistics of people walking away from church is true. If you've been attending here for a while, just look around at the faces who aren't here any longer. And it's not they left our church because they didn't like our church. They just simply don't go to church anymore. I can, you know, as I was doing this message, I was looking around, and I can probably name 25 people that came here and no longer come here. Now, we know that those things happen. I mean, if you know and familiar with the story, the parable of the seed, 75% of the people walked away from the seed that because of life circumstances, because they got choked out, or because it never took root, Satan came along, and there's all kinds of reasons that people stopped going to church. If you were to leave here because we're not feeding you and go somewhere else, I would certainly understand. And in fact, if you're not getting fed here, I would encourage you to do that. It's not about me. It's about all glory to God and what you're going to get out of it.
Amen.
But I do believe church attendance is important to God and important for your spiritual maturity. I believe that. Now, the bad news is most people don't attend church and they don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we could look at that as a problem, or we could look at it as an opportunity. And I believe we should look at it as an opportunity.
Amen.
And the opportunity is, in our nation today, we probably have the greatest harvest field that we've ever had in our nation's history, the best opportunity to spread the word of Jesus Christ than we've ever had since our country has been born. But the fact is, most people will come to church if they're invited. The other side of that coin, like I say sometimes, that no matter how thin the pancake, there's always another side, is most people will invite another church person to come to their church, but they're very, very uncomfortable inviting an unchurched person to church, somebody that doesn't go to church at all. And although I know it's higher in this church because I talk to you and I see the results of it, nationally, only 2% of Christians invite an unchurched person to church every year. Now, there's one church out there that says invite the three knots. Those that are not going to church, those that are not believing, and those where things are not going well. Now, as Tara said during the tithes and offerings, this church has made a difference in Pearland. And really, we say that, but that sounds sort of private. What the matter of fact is, God has used broken vessels like myself and some of you in here to make this church important to Tara and Bob. And His Holy Spirit is what's working in their life. It's not us. Next week, we have one of the greatest opportunities to invite the three knots. The not going, the not believing, the not going well. And we would encourage you to do that. And I don't normally do this, but I will tell you that we're investing a lot in this event. Not because it's an event for the Odyssey Church, but it's an event where we know there's going to be unchurched people here because we have been purposeful about inviting unchurched people here. So if you want to make an investment in the kingdom of God through the Odyssey Church and you get a blessing this week, you know, please go to our app or text it to us, because we are, you know, you're investing in somebody's future, and this is something that we normally don't do, and it's going to cost us a little bit of money, but it's going to be worth it. You know, I went to a B-Shot concert the other night, and not everybody would agree with that. A rapper singing Christian music. How many of you know there's no such thing as Christian music, only Christian lyrics? If you come next week, if everything works out and we're trying to put it together, we got to do the rehearsals. How many of you remember Three Dog Night, Joy to the World? Right. Not a Christian song. It will be. House of the Rising Sun.
Yes.
Words, not Christian. It will be. We're going to have some fun next week. So invest in it if you have the opportunity. Come if you have the opportunity. We're going to have games outside. We're going to have food. I'm just looking for an amazing event next week. We are praying diligently to fill this church and then some. We're borrowing 25 chairs from Mariners, and we're hoping that some of the kids have told us we don't mind standing, and we're hoping they're standing room only that day. Now, easiest way to invite somebody is to invite them to a special event. The knots are everywhere. We know that, don't we? We run into them all the time because they're not afraid to tell us the problems in their life, are they? They're not afraid to say, I don't believe as you do. They're not afraid to say, we don't go to church. The best way to invite somebody is to invite them to a banquet. A great banquet. See what I did there? Well, once again, you know, I do want to thank y'all for joining us here at the Odyssey. And there's people that join us online every week at www.theodysseychurch.com, and you're welcome to do that. There's people now, our app, I don't understand it. We haven't advertised it. It's not the way that I want to get it. Didn't want to advertise it. We come just here. But we've had about 100 downloads, which means somebody's getting it. We've had downloads from as far as California, all through the Midwest. I don't know where they're finding us at, but they are. So I praise God for that, because what we know is there's some people who won't or can't come to church, and we want to take the church to them. All our messages on there. I'm speaking to a gentleman right now. They're on, actually, it's a YouTube link, and that eats up a lot of data, so we're trying to get an audio link where we can start recording our messages on MP3 player and put them on audio. We think we'll get more response from that, just because it doesn't seem to have as much data. Some people are concerned about their data. I understand that. But I really want to take the time for those of you that actually got up this morning, especially if you only had 3 or 4 hours sleep, you got dressed, you drove here, those type of things, because you're really what encourages me week after week after week to keep doing what I'm doing, and I appreciate it so much. I believe that, and I think you believe this as well, you wouldn't hear that, our week just starts out a whole lot better when we started out with praising and worshiping and hearing God's word. When we come to God's house, our week just seems to go a little bit smoother than those weeks that we've been. And I know each one of you could be doing something different right now. But you said, God, I want to honor you. God, I want to do what you called me to do. God, I just want to put you first place in my life, so I'm getting up and I'm coming to church. And I think God looks down on that decision, and I think he's just looking down and he's smiling upon us this morning because of that. You know, when you take the time to worship him and hear his word, in the book of Hebrews, God says that, and he reminds us that he rewards those who diligently seek him. For those who diligently, who sincerely look for his will in our life. And I think that when we truly do that, then God can do some amazing things in our midst. There's a story in Scripture where Jesus is in the crowd, and they're actually trying to find him. And I mean, he's in the middle of this huge crowd, and they're going to throw him off a cliff. And he's not there. Now, we know he's in their midst, but they don't see him. And if you don't come to church expecting something from God, if you just come here out of obligation or for the wrong reasons, then I believe Jesus could be right in your midst. And just like those people that day, you'll miss it. We serve this amazing God. We serve this God that truly desires to make himself known to you. So I pray today that God will fill you with fresh peace and that fresh joy and fresh faith, fresh vision, and that you leave here better than you were when you came in, no matter how good you were or how bad you felt when you came in this morning, that you lead better than you are. Now, I'm going to start out this morning telling you a story. Now, I don't know if you see this. You might have seen this on Facebook. You may have seen it on the news. It's a story about a little boy named Gerald Hamilton. And he's about to turn 9 years old. And he wants to have a birthday party, just like most kids, right? So he wants to invite his friends from school. So his mom addresses and she sends out 30 invitations to all his classmates, inviting him to Gerald's 9th birthday party. Now, out of the 30, only 12 responded to the RSVP. And they all said that they would be there, and Gerald's excited. Okay, so the 30 aren't coming, but I got 12 that's coming. But the problem came when not 30 people showed up, but not even the 12 that said they would be there showed up. Nobody came to his birthday party. Now, what you may not know about Gerald is Gerald had never had a birthday party before. About 9 years, he's getting ready to turn 9 years old. But Gerald had some complications of the brain, and he had to have 5 major surgeries on his brain. And by his mom's own admission, this put him a little behind the rest of his classmates. But now at 9 years old, Gerald's finally better. There's no operation scheduled. He can have his very first birthday party. But nobody came. Not one person, not even the people who said they would be there, came. According to his grandmother, the party started at 3 o'clock, but at 5 o'clock, Gerald was still refusing to cut his cake because one person, just one person, might show up. Now, imagine if this was your grandchild, how you would feel. You know, you'd probably be mad, your heart would be broken. And this woman is hurt. She posts this on Facebook. She goes, I'm going to vent right now. And I'm reading this verbatim. My grandson, who is in second grade and had at least 5 skull expansion surgeries, is slower than the other kids in his class. However, he is the kindest, most passionate kid I know. His mother sent 30 invitations to his class. 12 said they were coming. At 3 o'clock, he made sure his goodie bags were ready. He had dressed, and he was ready to party. At 5 p.m., he was still sitting there, not wanting to cut his cake because one person might show up. When my daughter called the 12 parents to find out what was going on, here is their response. My child can't play with yours. He's just too different. How sad he is. He just wants to have friends. So no one came, no cards, no presents. So it's my mission to have as many cards as I can mail to my little guy. You can send them to me and I'll make sure he gets them. This breaks my heart. And she gives her name and address. And how sad is it? Imagine how brokenhearted she was and how brokenhearted his mother was. But imagine this. Imagine if God decided to throw a party. And he invites a whole bunch of people to come, and they all said they'd be there on that day. And all the people who said they'd be there, who responded to the invitation, he hosts his party, he tells his people to come out and get them to come in, and not one person shows up. Imagine how God would feel. Don't you think that maybe God would be mad? Don't you think that God's heart would be broken, just like Gerald's grandmother? Well, Jesus actually tells a story about this. It's recorded in the Gospel of Luke, where the story of Jesus' life as recorded by Luke. Now, you might remember that Luke was a doctor, and Luke did a very thorough investigation of all that he wrote, and he wouldn't write it unless he could verify that it actually took place. So Luke records these words of Jesus, and so the story is going to make a little bit more sense to us all. I'm going to give you a little bit about the backstory of what's going on in the life of Jesus and what leads him to tell this parable or this story of Luke chapter 14. And we're going to be looking at the scriptures from Luke 12 through 24. So just so that you can have a little bit of backstory and let you know what was going on. Now, at the time that Jesus walked the earth, it was the custom of the time. In fact, it was the law of the time. There were very strong laws about doing anything at all on the Sabbath, the day that was set apart for God. You could work, and you really couldn't do anything else. They had really strange laws. Like one of the laws they had is so crazy that you couldn't drag your toe across the sand, because if you did, that was considered work because you were digging a trench. I mean, they got so specific about the law. So what they would do is they would prepare their meals on the day before the Sabbath, and so that nobody had anything to do, they had these large dinners or these large banquets, and they would invite all their friends and family to come along, and they would just sit there all day long and eat and praise God and fellowship. Honey, sure sounds like heaven to me. Food, fellowship, and fun. Now, what's going on in this account is that Jesus has been invited to not only a Pharisee's house, but one of the leaders of the Pharisees. And the Pharisees were like the keepers of the law. They were the ones that knew the law. They were the ones that enforced the laws. They were the ones who believed in their heart that they followed all the rules. But we all know, you guys are smart people, you know there is no way to follow all the laws, even though they thought they might. And maybe they did follow them a little bit better than everybody else. But the problem is, even though they knew the law, even though they thought they kept them all perfectly, and like I said, maybe they did keep them better than most, no one could actually keep all the laws. And the average person at that time, the average Jew at the time, didn't even know all the laws. All they knew is every time they broke one, these Pharisees would point at them and condemn them. And they began to learn that no matter how hard they tried, they couldn't keep the laws at all. So they sort of lived in this bondage, in this fear of breaking the laws because of these Pharisees. And then they had the other people that they called the experts on the law, who were sort of like lawyers, who kept walking around and telling them all the things they were doing wrong and how they should live like they live. And they just walked around in fear and some kind of bondage all the time. And I think, you know, maybe some of you walked away from church for a while because of that very same reason. Maybe you had somebody who called themselves a Christian, and I don't question their salvation. I think there's a lot of good-meaning Christians that just do it wrong. But you walked away from church because no matter how hard you tried, you kept getting condemned for breaking the rules. Or maybe they would condemn you for breaking rules you didn't even know you were breaking. You know, I went to one church one time, and we used to keep candy in the back of the church. And the adults loved it. Kids really loved it. It was hard candy. But one Sunday, one kid left one piece of candy on a pew, and they took the candy out forever. We're not going to do it because kids don't know how to behave. They were enforcers of the law. So if that was you, I want you to know that's why we started the Odyssey Church. Because a lot of people with good intentions want to show the law of God and never show the love of God. And we want you to understand that it's God's love which brings us back to Him. If you come to Him out of fear, it is not a good relationship. You know, if you have somebody you love and you point a gun to their head and say, "Hey, you've got to love me," they may say it. But that's not a love relationship. So if you walked away from church because of rule enforcers or because of how you were treated, I understand that. I've lived that. Some of the people that I love the very most don't go to church right now because of how church people treat them. You know, one of the things that I think you know, we all know, one of the requirements of being a Jesus follower is that you're a sinner. We have to understand that. If we don't understand it, then what we become is rule enforcers. But if we're working on us, if I'm working on me, I don't have time to work on you. And when we start working on us, we begin to do what Christ calls us to do, which is to love one another. Being a sinner doesn't disqualify you from being a Jesus follower. It's a prerequisite for being a Jesus follower. If you could keep all the rules yourself, then you wouldn't need a savior, would you? Jesus invites the unbelievers and the misbehaviors to come to follow him. So anyway, got off topic there a little bit, I'm sorry. Jesus had been invited to this banquet at one of the leaders of the Pharisees' house, and it's on the Sabbath day, and looking at this with human eyes, you would think that this isn't going so well, particularly for the host and the experts of the law and the religious Jewish people there. And you would think that these religious experts of the law and the Pharisees would have learned by now. This is towards the end of Jesus' ministry. So you would think they would learn that, you know, either we need to embrace Jesus or we just need to ignore him and keep away from him. But obviously they haven't learned their lesson so well because they're still inviting Jesus to come to this banquet, not only at a Pharisee's house, but at one of the leaders. So the first thing that Luke mentions as Jesus comes to this banquet is Jesus looks around and he asks the host, which is the leader of the Pharisees, and the Pharisees around the experts hall, he asks him a simple question. Is it okay to heal on the Sabbath? Now he knew what their answer was going to be, and these Pharisees may not have learned not to invite Jesus to their house, but they learned not to ever challenge Jesus. So they just sit there. They don't say a word. They refuse to answer Jesus. Now, the reason they had learned this is because Jesus kept putting them through some very tough lessons. He kept putting them in very embarrassing situations. So they knew not to challenge him, so they just sit there quietly and they just refused to answer him. So what's Jesus do? Jesus heals a man with what's called dropsy. Most translations call it dropsy. Anyway, dropsy is this internal disease. It causes fluid buildup, it causes internal swelling, it causes great big large bloating, it disfigures you because of the bloating, the skin turns yellow from jaundice. And in today's world, we call it edema. There's a medical term for it, still exists today. But this man is near death, and according to the research that I've done, the Greek word implies that if the Lord himself didn't interfere in this man was going to die soon. He was so close to death that he may die while this banquet is actually going on. This man is, there's no hope for him whatsoever, and Jesus heals him in front of all the people after asking the question and then refusing the answer. Now, a lot of people believe that this man was a plant, that they had brought him to this dinner just simply to test Jesus to see if he would actually heal on the Sabbath, and Jesus does that. And it's not the first time he's done it. So he heals this man with dropsy on the Sabbath day and begins to teach all these religious people, all these religious Jewish people and the experts on the law and the Pharisees, begins to teach him a lesson. And I'm sure it's not a lesson they really wanted to learn, but he's going to teach them anyway. And he begins to explain to them how any one of you here would save his son if he fell on a pit on the Sabbath day. You'd do everything you could to save your son. You wouldn't let him lay in a pit and die. He said, in fact, if one of your cows fell on a pit, you would even save your cow. Now, if you're going to save your son or your cow on a Sabbath day, how can it be wrong to heal a man that's so sick on the Sabbath day? The Pharisees, they got nothing. They got nothing. They just sit there, their hands are lapped, and they're refusing to answer Jesus. Yeah, because they know he's right, but the law says he's not, and they're the keepers of the law. Jesus just went in for the kill. He's embarrassed his host. He's embarrassed the Pharisees there and the experts on the line. And as he's sitting there teaching this lesson, he's looking at the guests as they arrive. He's watching everybody in the room. Now, when he does that, he sees the exciting industry. But I think there's a small message in there, too. If Jesus, in all the limitations of his human body, would watch people then, now that he doesn't have the limitations of a human body, don't you think he might be still watching what we do today? And here's the thing. That's either very, very comforting or very, very scary based on your relationship with Jesus Christ. Yeah. If you're in a love relationship with Jesus Christ and you're doing what he calls you to do, you don't care that he might. The fact that he's watching over you is very comforting. But if you're in the dark places, if you're in the middle of secret sin, if you're doing things you know you shouldn't do, then that can be very, very scared. But Jesus, he's checking out the crowd. He sees the aggressors arriving. As they arrive, what they do is they see how close they can get to the head table. They want to sit in all the places of honor. They want to sit in the important seats. They want the front row. And Jesus begins to teach them another lesson. Probably another lesson they had no desire to learn at all. He tells them, you need to sit at the rear of the room. You need to sit in the lowest seats. He goes, let me tell you why you need to do that. Because if your host wants you to sit up front, then think of the honor you'll have as everybody looks around and you move from the back to the front. Think how they must feel, how important you must be. But if you're sitting at the front table and your host wants somebody else to sit there, he tells you to move, think how embarrassed you will be if you have to move to the back of the room. And this is how Jesus ends up his lesson on humility. Luke chapter 14, verse 12 and 14. Verse 12 through 14. Then he turned to the host. When you put on a luncheon or a banquet, he said, don't invite your friends, brothers, relatives, and rich neighbors. Well, they'll invite you back, and that will be your only reward. There'll be no reward for you in heaven, only on earth. He goes on to say, instead invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. Then at the resurrection of the righteous, God will reward you for inviting those who could not repay you. You want to have a party and invite your friends, it's okay. You don't expect a heavenly reward for it. But if you invite those that can't pay you back, if you take care of the crippled and the lame and the blind, God will reward you in heaven. Now, that sort of brings us to the question, does Jesus really mean the blind, the lame, the poor, the crippled? I think he does, and we'll see that in just a few minutes. But can you imagine how much tension had to be in this room at this moment? I mean, Jesus starts out by healing a man, knowing that this was going to upset his host, upset the Pharisees, upset the experts on the law. In fact, it's going to upset all the religious goody-goody Jewish people that are there. And then Jesus looks his host right in the eyes and looks around at the Pharisees, looks each of them in the eye, looks around the guests, and he corrects their manners. They're like, we're glad we invited Jesus today, man. We would have known this if he wasn't here. Jesus is all in their business, man. And nobody but Jesus is talking. I'm telling you, I bet you could cut the tension with a knife. And in this awkward moment of silence, sitting near Jesus, as this man gets sort of excited, just sort of works out, speaks out. And maybe it's to ease the tension of the moment. Maybe it's to ease the stress of the moment. Maybe he's trying to keep his host from being even more embarrassed than he already was. Maybe he was trying to do what I've done in my life, and I'll be transparent and tell you, I try to sound more religious than I am by trying to say the right thing. Particularly before I knew Jesus, and you're at a wedding, you're talking to the pastor, and you're trying to sound religious, and you're not really religious, but you're trying to sound that way. Maybe it's a combination of all these things. But he says, hearing this, the man sitting at the table with Jesus exclaimed, what a blessing it will be to attend a banquet in the kingdom of God. Now, in the Greek, it actually says, what a blessing it will be able to eat bread in the kingdom of God. We translate it that. Whatever this man's motive is, he probably wishes he'd never said anything at all. I mean, I'm sure I can think in his thought pattern. I don't know for sure, but he's probably thinking, okay, let me say something that there's no way that Jesus can argue with this, and there's no way that the Pharisees can argue with this, and let's bring this conversation back into focus. Let's bring this group back together, and let's turn this back into a joyous banquet instead of Jesus just embarrassing everybody. But Jesus being Jesus doesn't pass an opportunity to teach somebody a lesson, does he? And this time Jesus is going to go in deep. He's going to dig deep. The Pharisees and all the experts on the law, all these religious goody-goody people, they thought they were the only ones that were going to get into heaven. They thought they kept the law perfectly and they were getting to heaven. And if you were anything but them, you wouldn't get into heaven. If you were sick, if you were poor, if you were lame, that meant that God had no favor upon you. So even if you were Jewish, you couldn't get into heaven. And then anybody who wasn't Jewish, what we call the Gentiles, that's most of us in this room, well, there's no hope for you getting to heaven. Heaven is for us, Evan is not for anybody else. We're the law keepers, we're enforcers. You don't act like us, look like us, talk like us, you can't get into heaven. But Jesus, not going to pass the opportunity to teach, he's about to show them through an illustration how wrong they really are. And really, as I look at this, this should be a warning to the church today. By church, I mean the Big C church. Those that are invited to church. Many people are invited to God's great banquet, but very few people truly accept the invitation. Most people today, just like Karen and Rob were talking about during the opening this morning, make excuses as why they can't do what God calls them to do. They have all kinds of excuses. So Jesus, as you're going to see, he puts together this parable. Jesus puts together this story so that he can make a point. And the first point is so obvious. It speaks to everyone about answering God's invitation to his banquet and the consequences of making excuses for not coming and not answering God's call. And not everyone who's even accepted his invitation is going to get into his banquet. Now, to help you understand why, you know, a little more history of this time here. At the time Jesus was walking on the earth, the custom when these would have these great banquets is they would send out an invitation. The king, particularly when he was having a great celebration, would send out an invitation to the people he wanted to go there. It was a very general invitation. It didn't have a lot of details on it. And you had to RSVP for it so that he would know how many cows to have ready, and how much, you know, food to put out. You know, it's sort of like today. We send out invitation. I had the very great privilege yesterday of attending and performing a wedding ceremony, and they sent out invitations. They wanted to know how much food they had to make, how many people were there. Well, the king was the same way, but they didn't really put a time on there. It was very general. And then at the time of the feast, he would send out his servants to go tell people who was ready to come to the banquet. So this is the illustration that Jesus has used. So you can see this as you begin to do so. It's at the time of the first invitation, everybody said yes, but as the second invitation came, the people started making excuses. So you can fairly easily see what Jesus is making in the large point. Jesus says, God sent an invitation to his banquet, and some of you have said yes. Some of you said yes, Jesus is both my Lord and my Savior, but you're making excuses to do some things that he's told you not to do, or you're making excuses not to do what he's told you to do. Yeah, Lord, I've accepted your invitation, but now that you're calling me to do this and really come in, maybe not right now, okay? Maybe later. I've got this to do, I've got that to do. God's inviting you to his banquet with somebody, and some people, and I hope there's nobody in here, but we know people that they make excuses for not doing what the great King, God, Jesus Christ, has told them to do. And one day God sends out a final invitation, and you don't know the day, and you don't know the time, but one day you're going to meet him face to face. He gives you the final invitation, and you stand before him, and he says, you didn't come when I called you. And he shuts the door to his banquet forever. It's shut for all eternity. Now, that's pretty obvious, and that's easy to see. You know, you've got others that, you know, maybe they reject the invitation right up front, or maybe they don't even know they got an invitation yet. They've been offered it. But that's where the finer points come in. And when you get to finer points, sometimes it's like looking at a picture with very great detail, the finer points are harder to see until you look closer. So this message is really for those who have answered the first invitation, and we're going to look at the finer points of what Jesus is talking about. This message, if you're not a Christian, you don't have to do anything that this says. It's not, you know, but if you are, not only have said yes to God's first invitation, but they're prepared for his second invitation. They're the ones who know that God has called them and that they're willing to do what God has told them to do, and they want to attend this great banquet they know one day that they're going to be able to attend. Now, if you think about this, if we believe God is king, then we have to understand if you're not a king, you're required to do what the king says. If you're not the king, to some degree, everybody is a servant of the king. In this parable, Jesus tells us in the pointer points what we're to do as God's servants. So now that we have the context of the time period, let's move to the parable of the great feast as told by Jesus and recorded by Dr. Luke. Beginning in Luke chapter 14, verse 16 through 17, and I'm reading it from the New Living Translation. Jesus replied with this story. A man prepared a great feast and sent out many invitations. When the banquet was ready, he sent his servant to tell the guests, "Come, the banquet is ready." But they all began to make excuses. How many people do you know that make excuses? Some people, maybe they never responded. Maybe they were like the, 18 people that didn't respond at all to Gerald's invitation to come to his party. Maybe they're like the other 12. When Gerald's mom started the call, they all had an excuse. And you know what the fact is? Maybe some of them had a very legitimate excuse. You know, we don't know. All we know for sure is nobody showed up. Everybody had an excuse. Everybody had a reason for not coming to his party that they were invited to, and they had accepted the invitation. And that's what Jesus is talking about here. And so Jesus goes on and says, but they all began making excuses. Some said, "I have just bought a field, and I must inspect it." Okay? Look at what Jesus says when he starts looking at these excuses. He says, this person's talking about material. So these are the things that I have. And because I have these things, I can't come to your banquet, God. And we know people let material things get in their way of coming to church, don't we? And another said, they just bought 5 pairs of oxen, and I want to try them out. Right? That's their vocation. That's their job. You know, I love my wife dearly, and I truly do. And I know she believes in God with all her heart, but she works Sundays. And she says, "Well, Rob, you know, you don't take a salary from the church. Somebody's got to make the income." But honestly, as much as I love her, I think sometimes it's an excuse not to come to church. And I'm speaking, again, I try to be transparent. You know, this is my own wife. It happens. People have to work on Sundays. We live in this very busy world. Another said, "I have a wife, a new wife, and I can't come." Now, that's relationship, that's family. And how many people do you know, I know I haven't been in church in the last, you know, summertime, we just have vacations, and we go to the beach, and, you know, we're going to, you know, there's always something to do, kids got ball people. But God, here's God, and he's saying they're doing the same thing that Gerald's friends did. They're making an excuse why they can't come. And maybe some of their excuses are legitimate, but God is our king, and we're his servants, and the king says, you know, here's the point. I want you to put me first. That's what Jesus is saying here. God, our king, has to come first in our lives. And you may have some good reasons, and you know, maybe some people have even excellent reasons to keep them from doing and responding to God's invitation. But good excuses and excellent reasons don't pass for disguises for not responding to the king's invitation. When Gerald's classmates didn't respond to the invitation, Gerald's grandmother got mad. She said her heart was breaking. And Jesus tells us that's exactly how God feels when we don't respond to his invitation. The servant returned and told his master what they had said. His master was furious. I mean, it's not only that he gets mad, he says he gets furious. He said, "Go quickly into the streets and the alleys of the town. They make excuses. They come. They don't come. Gerald's friends rejects his invitation. His grandmother got mad. But let me ask you a question. Did she get mad and wait a couple weeks and then go to Facebook? Or did she get mad and go quickly to Facebook and start there? She went right away, didn't she? She went right away, and she writes this post, and you can sure look at this, and she's putting on Facebook. Well, the Greek word that Jesus uses here is a Greek word that is takios. And takios means, it's an adverb, it means soon, it means quickly, it means hastily, it means right away. And God says, this ain't a suggestion, okay? This is a command. And yet, only 2% of people who call themselves Christians, who accepted the first invitation, go out and do what God tells them to do. Only about 2% go out and invite the unchurched to come into this banquet. And that's a scary statistic, because some people, again, I hope it's not anybody here, but some people make excuses for not doing what the king has told them to do. And it breaks him apart. It makes him angry. In fact, Jesus said it makes him furious. It closes the door and you can't enter into his banquet. Now, maybe this, you know, think about it this way. You know a firefighter, and there's a house burning, you call a fire department, and you do 911. And firemen, they can actually see, you know, about 3 miles down the road there's the house that's burning on fire, and they know that their people are trapped in the house, and they're going to perish if they don't do anything. But instead of rushing up and getting all the firefighter equipment on and loading up in the fire truck with the lights and the sirens blaring and riding there as fast as they can, they get in the minivan. And they take a nice, slow, comfortable ride. And they're looking around. And they can see this hellish fire and the people about to perish. They're riding down the road and they're going, you know, look at that house over there. Isn't that lawn so green? Isn't it so nice? That house ain't burning down. They're good. In fact, look at all these houses around here. They're all, none of them, we only got one burning down. And our boss is probably so proud of us. We're just going to ride. We'll get there sooner or later. You know, sooner or later, they not come. I mean, maybe they're thinking to themselves, well, maybe they don't even know their house is on fire. Maybe they don't even know that they have this possibility of burning up. You know what we do as Christians sometimes? I mean, if we really believe what we say we believe, and we know people are in jeopardy of burning in the fires of hell, shouldn't we be like those firefighters? Shouldn't we stop making excuses? Shouldn't we go out and surround ourselves with those who are unchurched? But instead, a lot of times we do just the opposite. We make excuses and we surround ourselves with people who are already saved, and we have these nice conversations, and we're like firefighters who aren't going through the fire. They're just looking around at all the houses that aren't on fire. Sooner or later, it might be too late. Pretend like you're a firefighter. Pretend like you know that the people you love are in jeopardy of dying in a fire and being tormented if you don't do anything. God says, go quickly. Go soon. Go now. Go right away. Go hastily. All of those are different translations of this word takios. Invite people to the king's banquet. Start by inviting them to our banquet next week. We'll feed them spiritually, and then we'll feed them physically. But they ain't coming without an invitation. And who do you think Jesus tells us to go invite? He says, go quickly, go soon, go now, go right away, go hastily into the streets and the alleys of the town. And invite the poor, invite the crippled, invite the blind, and invite the lame. Now again, you know, that begs the question, does Jesus mean the actual poor, the actual crippled, the actual blind, and the actual lame? I think of course he does. But I think, and again, you're all smart people, you know this too, Jesus also means those who are spiritually poor, those who don't know of God's invitation to his wealth of this banquet, the spiritually blind, those who haven't seen the love of God's people, the spiritually crippled, the spiritually, maybe those people who have hearts like the Pharisees. They're full of law and they're not full of love. Maybe they've been spiritually crippled because of false teaching that they've been exposed to. Spiritually lame because the people who call themselves Christian hurt them and damaged them and disabled them and deformed them with their religious laws and rules of man and their condemnation. Maybe those that are spiritually poor and spiritually blind and spiritually crippled by drug addiction, by alcohol, by the ways of this world. You know, maybe they're facing bankruptcy. Maybe they're facing divorce or some kind of disease they can't even pronounce the name of. Or they're in despair, or they're depressed, or some other crippling problem. Right, those that are in the midst of terrible, terrible sin. The adulterers, the thieves, the greedy. In other words, Jesus said, go quickly, go now, go right away, go hastily. Just go invite everybody you come into contact with. Let them know being a sinner doesn't disqualify you from the king's banquet. It's a prerequisite for going to the king's banquet. You don't have to be a goody-goody. You have to be a sinner to get invited. God invites the misbehaviors. He invites the poor, the crippled, the blind. He invites the lame. He even invites the unbelievers to come to his banquet. All are invited. See, you don't get cleaned up and washed up to come to the banquet. You go to the banquet to get cleaned up. The first thing we have to know is that we have to go. We have to go soon. We have to go right now. We have to go hasty, and we have to invite everybody. And then who do we invite, and where do we find them, and how do we get them to do this? You go quickly, after the servant had done this, he reported, there is still room for more. Look around, folks. There's still room for more in here. So his master said, go out into the country lanes and behind the hedges and urge anyone you find to come so that the house will be full. See, not only are we supposed to go quickly, not only are we to invite everybody, we're to go everywhere. That means sometimes we have to go outside our comfort zone, right? We have to go out to the places which maybe are unfamiliar to us. The ones who are not like us. The ones who don't dress like us. The ones who don't talk like us. The ones that don't act like us. The people who maybe were even uncomfortable being around. And it's not a simple invitation and walk away. And the king says to urge them. Some translation says to compel them. One says to constrain them to come in. Another says make them come in. Let me ask you, how many of you as children went to church because your parents said you had to go to church? Right. You were compelled to go. You were made to go. This is the kind of thing Jesus is talking about. But almost everybody, whether their parents made them go to church, the first time they went to church, they went because of an invitation. Now, it could have been an invitation that was sent to mail, but most of the time it's a personal invitation from a friend. I surrendered my life. I started going back to church. I started following Jesus because my sister would not leave me alone. She was involved in a large church down in Salisbury, and every week she asked me to go, and truly, I think the first time I went, I just went to shut her up. And the rest is history. She compelled me. Now, the Greek word, again, I know you didn't think you were getting a Greek lesson today, is anagkazo, anagkazos. And it's a verb. And I do want you to know this. I've never studied Greek, but I study people who do study Greek. So, what I know about this word, what I've learned about this word, this is a very, very strong word that Jesus decides to use here. It actually means to compel. In its root, it means to force someone to come to the banquet of the king. Tara, can you change that slide, please? It's not what you would like. You're not going up to somebody and saying, would you like to come to church with me on Sunday? No? Okay. Probably. That's not what he's talking about here. We're to go quickly. We're to go right away. We're to go hastily. We're to invite everybody everywhere to this great banquet, our Lord, our King, and we're to compel them, even force them, and we're to do so with urgency. And this is so important because of what the next verse says. The next verse says, for none of those I first invited will even get the smallest taste of my name. If you're invited and you don't come like Gerald's classmates didn't come, you don't even get the taste of cake. If you don't take the king, if you don't take King Jesus upon his invitation, if you don't do the will of King Jesus, you don't even get to taste the smallest portion of his great banquet. And we are, according to the word of Jesus, we are to invite everyone we meet, invite everywhere we go, even to the places we don't like going. We'll go down the country lane, we'll go down the hedges. We are to invite, to compel these people with great urgency to come to the king's banquet. Isn't that exactly what Gerald's grandmother did? I mean, if you think about it. I mean, she didn't go out and re-invite all those people who didn't come the first time, did she? She got mad. She got angry when nobody showed up. Her heart was breaking, so she goes out and compels everywhere and everyone to come with great urgency. You remember her words? How sad he is. Gerald just wants to have friends. So no one came. No cards, no presents. So it is my mission to have as many cards as I can mailed to my little card. You can send them to me and I'll make sure he gets them. This breaks my heart. Now, that's Paul Harvey. If you remember Paul Harvey, here's where I am. Here's the rest of the story. You know what happened when this grandmother quickly invited others? When she invited everybody, everywhere, and she held them with a sense of urgency to accept her invitation. She got more, her family got more, Gerald got more than they could ever imagine or even expect. According to NBC Chicago and Today.com, when she invited, when she compelled with a sense of urgency, the people responded, and boy, did they respond. The next morning, the very next morning, there was a package at the door, and she said the cards just kept coming in and coming in. Now, as of April 4th, now remember, this is only 2 or 3 weeks after her first post. The post had been shared over 3,400 times. And as the news of these letters got out, Gerald was invited to the city council meeting. And at this city council meeting, he's given a surprise birthday party. It's filled with gifts. They even bring the canine dog in for him to play with. His grandmother told the Today Show, he was really sad the day of his party. Now he feels like it's his birthday because he's getting cards. See, when you invite, and not just invite, but compel with urgency, people will respond. We have to do our part. We have to extend the invitation. We need to stop making excuses and go out quickly. We need to go out now. We need to go out right away. We need to go out patiently to everyone, everywhere, even those who don't look like us, those that don't talk like us, those that don't act like us, those that we aren't comfortable around, everyone, everywhere, and we're to do so with a sense of urgency. Now, I want you to try to imagine this in your mind's eye. What would this place look like if each of us did it? What if we did the same thing Gerald's grandmother did? We got a broken heart because people weren't responding to God's invitation. That we went out and we were like a firefighter rushing to a burning valley, saving those that are in jeopardy of perishing in a fire. That if we went out and we invited quickly, that we invited everyone everywhere, if we invited compellingly with a sense of urgency, if you invite, they will come. Can you imagine how packed this church would be next week? Verse 22 says, there is still room for more. Look around you this morning. Each one of these empty seats represents somebody. It represents a father. It represents a mother. It represents a child. It represents a boss. It represents a neighbor. It represents the guy at the grocery store. It represents the guy that's homeless. It represents the drug addict. It represents the alcoholic. It represents the guy who's going through a divorce. How do we get said yes to God's first invitation, but they're prepared for his second invitation. They're the ones who know that God has called them and that they're willing to do what God has told them to do, and they will attend this great banquet they know one day that they're going to be able to attend. Now, if you think about this, if we believe God is king, then we have to understand if you're not a king, you're required to do what the king says. If you're not the king, to some degree, everybody is a servant of the king. In this parable, Jesus tells us in the 400 points what we're to do as God's servants. So now that we have the context of the time period, let's move to the parable of the great feast as told by Jesus and recorded by Dr. Luke. Beginning in Luke chapter 14, verse 16 through 17, and I'm reading it from the New Living Translation. Jesus replied with this story. A man prepared a great feast and sent out many invitations. When the banquet was ready, he sent his servant to tell the guests, "Come, the banquet is ready." But they all began to make excuses. How many people do you know that make excuses? Some people, maybe they never responded. Maybe they were like the 18 people that didn't respond at all to Gerald's invitation to come to his party. Maybe they're like the other 12. When Gerald's mom started to call, they all had an excuse. And you know what? The fact is, maybe some of them had a very legitimate excuse. You know, we don't know. All we know for sure is nobody showed up. Everybody had an excuse. Everybody had a reason for not coming to his party that they were invited to, and they had accepted the invitation. And that's what Jesus is talking about here. And so Jesus goes on and says, but they all began making excuses. Some said, "I have just bought a field, and I must inspect it." Okay? Look at what Jesus says when he starts looking at these excuses. He says, this person's talking about material. So these are the things that I have. And because I have these things, I can't come to your banquet, God. And we know people who let material things get in their way of coming to church, don't we? And another said, they just bought 5 pairs of oxen, and I want to try them out. Right? That's their vocation. That's their job. You know, and I love my wife dearly. And I truly do. And I know she believes in God with all her heart, but she works Sundays. And she says, "Well, Rob, you know, you don't take a salary from the church. Somebody's got to make the income." But honestly, as much as I love her, I think sometimes it's an excuse not to come to church. And I'm speaking, again, I try to be transparent. You know, this is my own wife. It happens. People have to work on Sundays. We live in this very busy world. Notice that I have a wife, a new wife, and I can't come. Now, that's relationship, that's family. And how many people do you know, I know I haven't been to church in the last, you know, summertime, we just have vacations, and we go to the beach, and, you know, we're going to, you know, there's always something to do. Kids got to ball game. But God, here's God, and he's saying they're doing the same thing that Gerald's friends did. They're making an excuse why they can't come. And maybe some of their excuses are legitimate, but God is our king, and we're his servants, and the king says, you know, here's the point. I want you to put me first. That's what Jesus is saying here. God, our king, has to come first in our lives. And you may have some good reason, and you know, maybe some people have even excellent reasons to keep them from doing and responding to God's invitation. But good excuses and excellent reasons don't pass for disguises for not responding to the king's invitation. When Gerald's classmates didn't respond to the invitation, Gerald's grandmother got mad. She said her heart was breaking. And Jesus tells us that's exactly how God feels when we don't respond to his invitation. The servant returned and told his master what they had said. His master was furious. I mean, it's not only that he gets mad, he says he gets furious. He said, "Go quickly into the streets and the alleys of the town. They make excuses. They come. They don't come. Gerald's friends rejects his invitation. His grandmother got mad." But let me ask you a question. Did she get mad and wait a couple weeks and then go to Facebook? Or did she get mad and go quickly to Facebook and start then? She went right away, didn't she? She went right away and she writes this post and you can sure look at this and she's putting on Facebook. Well, Well, the Greek word that Jesus uses here is a Greek word that is takios. And takios means, it's an adverb, it means soon, it means quickly, it means hastily, it means right away. God says, this ain't a suggestion, okay? This is a command. And yet, only 2% of people who call themselves Christians, who accepted the first invitation, go out and do what God tells them to do. Only about 2% go out and invite the unchurched to come into this banquet. And that's a scary statistic, because some people, and again, I hope it's not anybody here, but some people make excuses for not doing what the king has told them to do. And it breaks him apart. It makes him angry. In fact, Jesus said it makes him furious. He closes the door, and you can't enter into his banquet. Now, maybe this, you know, think about it this way. You know a firefighter, and there's a house burning. You call a fire department, and you do 911. And a fireman, they can actually see, you know, about 3 miles down the road there, there's the house that's burning on fire, and they know that their people are trapped in the house, and they're going to perish if they don't do anything. But instead of rushing up and getting all the firefighter equipment on and loading up in the fire truck with the lights and the sirens blaring and riding there as fast as they can, they get in the minivan. And they take a nice, slow, comfortable ride. And they're looking around. And they can see this hellish fire and the people about to perish. They're riding down the road and they're going, you know, look at that house over there. Isn't that lawn so green? Isn't it so nice? That house ain't burning down. They're good. In fact, look at all these houses around here. They're all better. We only got one burning down. And our boss is probably so proud of us. We're just going to ride. We'll get there sooner or later. You know, sooner or later, they not come. I mean, maybe they're thinking to themselves, well, maybe they don't even know their house is on fire. Maybe they don't even know that they have this possibility of burning up. You know what we do as Christians sometimes? I mean, if we really believe what we say we believe, and we know people are in jeopardy of burning in the fires of hell, shouldn't we be like those firefighters? Shouldn't we stop making excuses? Shouldn't we go out and surround ourselves with those who are unchurched? But instead, a lot of times we do just the opposite. We make excuses and we surround ourselves with people who are already saved, and we have these nice conversations, and we're like firefighters who aren't going through the fire. They're just looking around at all the houses that aren't on fire. Sooner or later, it might be too late. Pretend like you're a firefighter. Pretend like you know that the people you love are in jeopardy of dying in a fire and being tormented if you don't do anything. God says, go quickly. Go soon. Go now. Go right away. Go hastily. All of those are different translations of this word takios. Invite people to the king's banquet. Start by inviting them to our banquet next week. We'll feed them spiritually, and then we'll feed them physically. But they ain't coming without an invitation. And who do you think Jesus tells us to go invite? He says, go quickly, go soon, go now, go right away, go hastily into the streets and the alleys of the town, and invite the poor, invite the crippled, invite the blind, and invite the lame. Now again, you know, it begs the question, does Jesus mean the actual poor, the actual crippled, the actual blind, and the actual lame? I think of course he does. But I think, and again, you're all smart people, you know this too. Jesus also means those who are spiritually poor, those who don't know of God's invitation to his wealth of this banquet. The spiritually blind, those who haven't seen the love of God's people. The spiritually crippled, the spiritually lame, maybe those people who have hearts like the Pharisees. They're full of law and they're not full of love. Maybe they've been spiritually crippled because of false teaching that they've been exposed to. Spiritually lame because the people who call themselves Christians hurt them and damage them and disable them and deform them with their religious laws and rules of man and their condemnation. Maybe those that are spiritually poor and spiritually blind and spiritually crippled by drug addiction, by alcohol, by the ways of this world. You know, maybe they're facing bankruptcy. Maybe they're facing divorce or some kind of disease they can't even pronounce the name of. Or they're in despair, they're depressed, or some other crippling problem. Like those that are in the midst of terrible, terrible sin. The adulterers, the thieves, the greedy. In other words, Jesus said, go quickly, go now, go right away, go hasten. Just go invite everybody you come into contact with. Let them know being a sinner doesn't disqualify you from the king's banquet. It's a prerequisite for going to the king's banquet. You don't have to be a goody-good. You have to be a sinner to get invited. God invites the misbehaviors. He invites the poor, the crippled, the blind. He invites the lame. He even invites the unbelievers to come to his banquet. All are invited. See, you don't get cleaned up and washed up to come to the banquet. You go to the banquet to get cleaned up. The first thing we have to know is that we have to go. We have to go soon. We have to go right now. We have to go hasten, and we have to invite everybody. And then who do we invite, and where do we find them, and how do we get them to do this? You go quickly after the servant had done this, he reported, there is still room for more. Look around, folks. There's still room for more in here. So his master said, go out into the country lanes and behind the hedges and urge anyone you find to come so that the house will be full. See, not only are we supposed to go quickly, not only are we to invite everybody, we're to go everywhere. That means sometimes we have to go outside our comfort zone, right? We have to go out to the places which maybe are unfamiliar to us. The ones who are not like us. The ones who don't dress like us. The ones who don't talk like us. The ones that don't act like us. The people who maybe were even uncomfortable being around. And it's not a simple invitation and walk away. The king says to urge them. Some translation says to compel them. One says to constrain them to come in. Another says make them come in. Let me ask you, how many of you as children went to church because your parents said you had to go to church? You were compelled to go. You were made to go. This is the kind of thing Jesus is talking about. But almost everybody, whether their parents made them go to church, the first time they went to church, they went because of an invitation. Now, it could have been an invitation that was sent to mail, but most of the time it's a personal invitation from a friend. I surrendered my life. I started going back to church. I started following Jesus because my sister would not leave me alone. She was involved in a large church down in Salisbury, and every week she asked me to go, and truly, I think the first time I went, I just went to shut her up. And the rest is history. But she compelled me. Now, the Greek word, again, I know you didn't think you were getting a Greek lesson today, is anagkazo, anagkazo. And it's a verb. And I do want you to know this. I've never studied Greek, but I study people who do study Greek. So, what I know about this word, what I've learned about this word, this is a very, very strong word that Jesus decides to use here. It actually means to compel. In its root, it means to force someone to come to the banquet of the king. Tara, can you change that slide, please? It's not what you would like. You're not going up to somebody and saying, would you like to come to church with me on Sunday? No? Okay. Probably bother you. That's not what he's talking about. We're to go quickly. We're to go right away. We're to go hastily. We're to invite everybody everywhere to this great banquet, our Lord, our King, and we're to compel them, even force them, and we're to do so with urgency. And this is so important because of what the next verse says. The next verse says, for none of those I first invited will even get the smallest taste of my banquet. If you're invited and you don't come like Gerald's classmates didn't come, you won't even get the taste of cake. If you don't take the king, if you don't take King Jesus upon his invitation, if you don't do the will of King Jesus, you don't even get to taste the smallest portion of his great banquet. And we are, according to the word of Jesus, we are to invite everyone we meet, invite everywhere we go, even to the places we don't like going, where we go down the country lanes, we go down the edges. We are to invite, to compel these people with great urgency to come to the king's banquet. Isn't that exactly what Gerald's grandmother did? I mean, if you think about it. I mean, she didn't go out and re-invite all those people who didn't come the first time, did she? She got mad. She got angry when nobody showed up. Her heart was breaking, so she goes out and compels everywhere and everyone to come with great ears. You remember her words? How sad he is. Gerald just wants to have friends. So no one came, no cards, no presents. So it is my mission to have as many cards as I can mailed to my little card. You can send them to me and I'll make sure he gets them. This breaks my heart. Now, that's Paul Harvey. If you remember Paul Harvey, here's the rest of the story. You know what happened when this grandmother quickly invited others? When she invited everybody, everywhere, and she compelled them with a sense of urgency to accept her invitation. She got more, her family got more, Gerald got more than they could ever imagine or even expect. According to NBC Chicago and Today.com, when she invited, when she compelled with a sense of urgency, the people responded, and boy, did they respond. The next morning, very next morning, there was a package at the door, and she said the cards just kept coming in and coming in. Now, as of April 4th, now remember, this is only 2 or 3 weeks after her first post. The post had been shared over 3,400 times. And as the news of these letters got out, Gerald was invited to the city council meeting, and at this city council meeting, he's given a surprise birthday party. It's filled with gifts. They even bring the canine dog in for him to play with. His grandmother told the Today Show he was really sad the day of his party, but now he feels like it's his birthday because he's getting cards. See, when you invite, and not just invite, but compel with their urgency, people will respond. We have to do our part. We have to extend the invitation. We need to stop making excuses and go out quickly. We need to go out now. We need to go out right away. We need to go out patiently to everyone, everywhere, even those who don't look like us, those that don't talk like us, those that don't act like us, those that we aren't comfortable around. Everyone, everywhere, and we're to do so with a sense of urgency. Now, I want you to try to imagine this in your mind's eye. What would this place look like if each of us did it? What if we did the same thing Gerald's grandmother did? We got a broken heart because people weren't responding to God's invitation. That we went out and we were like a firefighter rushing to a burning valley, saving those that are in jeopardy of perishing in a fire. That if we went out and we invited quickly, that we invited everyone everywhere, if we invited compellingly with a sense of urgency, if you invite, they will come. Can you imagine how packed this church would be next week? Verse 22 says, there is still room for more. Look around you this way. Each one of these empty seats represents somebody. It represents a father. It represents a mother. It represents a child. It represents a boss. It represents a neighbor. It represents the guy at the grocery store. It represents the guy that's homeless. It represents the drug addict. It represents the alcoholic. It represents the guy who